Ajith is a very sensible person in that sense, and he really got on top of the game with that film. Anushka's character was not there in my original idea. When Vivek could say something extra in praise of Ajith, Ajith would tone it down, saying, no, don't do that.
So the films you're known for are typically the finely shaded romance or the cop movie. What is your interest in the cop movie?
I somewhere associate action and violence with police officers. I think for that to work in the life of an ordinary man, as in somebody like you or me or a bank officer or somebody who's a doctor, is a little far-fetched. He might see something violent happening, which is also a rarity, but with policemen, with cops, you can actually explore the possibility of getting into a violent zone, or, you know, there's action, there could be a thriller moment and stuff like that. So since I try and keep it as real as possible, I'm fascinated by writing a cop story when I want to do an action film. So.
But there are a lot of films in Tamil cinema that come out where ordinary men are action heroes as well, right? That doesn't interest you?
Not so much. And then I think maybe the few that really worked for me have already been done.
Okay.
Might not be a great example, but I liked Run a lot.
Right.
So then if I'm thinking of anything else, the maximum I could do is a boy who falls in love with a girl and has a spat with his brother.
Right,
so,
right.
But if I want to go, you know, the whole hog with gangsters and cops and maybe even a Dheeran-like film, you know, a cop story works.
Let's take your cop trilogy, right? When you made your Kaakha Kaakha with Suriya, he was not yet a very big established star. So you were fairly free to play around with this character. When you did Vettaiyaadu Vilaiyaadu with Kamal Haasan, he is an actor that's known for doing slightly different things. So he's not, I mean, the audience isn't going to take him to task. But when you get a star like Ajith, and especially in today's milieu of Tamil cinema, which is much more, I would say, mass-oriented than it was maybe even 10 years ago, did you wonder at any point, like, you're introducing him in business class and he's speaking so much English and all those kinds of things, those little things, did that, you know, nobody got cold feet at any point?
No, Ajith was always telling me, I'm coming to do a film with you. I don't want you to change anything around for me. And then people will say, you know, that you did it for me. So we discussed something like a Vettaiyaadu, an extension of the same character. And he liked the idea. And we set it up. And there were a lot more lines in the film that didn't make it to the final cut, which when I was reading the scene out and I said, this is what you'll say, he would say, no, see, again, here you're towing the line. Let's not do this. Let's tone it down. You're doing it really for me and stuff like that. So there was no tweaking the script to suit Ajith's mass image or anything like that at all. Not on Yennai Arindhaal.
I have a question simply because, you know, you just mentioned mass image and all that, and there's usually this thing about, will the audience accept such a thing, right? Or will this hero's fans accept such a thing? Now, you have your cop movies, one of the things about them is they show the cops not just as macho people, but also very vulnerable and romantic people. So, you know, like for instance, there's this place where there's that big sickle kind of thing that gets into Ajith's leg and foot and stuff, and he ends up in a hospital. Now, these kind of things, there was never any doubt that this was exactly the way you were going to go. Is that?
Yeah, there was never any doubt. He had no issues with this.
Okay.
I've never really bothered about the mass image of the heroes. Even with Kamal sir, we made him to a large extent vulnerable. Yes, we did bring in the instinct factor and the fact that he knows a lot. But there were moments when he's desperate and, you know,
right,
which ideally you wouldn't have seen in some other kind of film. And I think, obviously, you know, I shouldn't even be saying it, but Ajith is a very sensible person in that sense. And he really got on top of the game with that film, you know, and it was exactly as the way we envisioned it right from the word go. The climax, we left a little open, and the producer wanted to shoot the climax at the harbour and make it really big and all that. But when I told him this is how it ends, it should end where it began, we narrowed it down to the house. He loved the idea. So he was completely with me on that film. If I had tweaked it a little more, maybe in that sense, that's what the audience likes, or that generally larger audience, maybe the film would have done better. I don't know. But I stuck to what I felt was true about the film, you know, so.
So the parts where Anushka says, you know, he's so handsome, that, all that kind of stuff. That's also, you did it for the audience,
no,
it's just
no. It was written into the script. I think it's what I felt also, just generally interacting and talking to him. I think he's a really good looking guy, and I didn't have any doubts that a woman would feel the same way. There were a couple of things like, you know, Anushka's character was not there in my original idea. It was just between Satyadev and Himanika and the child and Victor and the villain and, you know, all that. But Anushka was already signed on to do a film with Ratnam and Ajith sir. So when I went in, they'd already said Anushka. But I wanted to cast Trisha in the role of Hemanika. So I had to kind of weave Anushka into the story, which if you ask me in retrospect, that's the thing that I felt didn't work with the film. Later, it was okay. You know, when she comes into that house and when Unkannenna Venum Sollu plays back in the other version and all that, right. It worked for me. But the beginning portions, I feel, you know, that I didn't really... It didn't work for me very organically. But otherwise, with everything else, like I said, there was just no issue at all.
Okay.
In fact, when Vivek and Ajith, there was some banter between them, and when Vivek could say something extra in praise of Ajith, Ajith would tone it down, saying, no, don't do that. They'll think I only made Gautham write this and stuff. So he was very conscious of that right through.
You had two very high-profile collaborators in the writing in terms of Shridhar Raghavan and Thiagarajan Kumararaja. What did they bring to the script?
Yeah, I've always looked to reach out to a few writers. I've asked you also if, you know, we can collaborate on something. It's just that Shridhar's always, you know, been there. He's like a good friend. At the same time, he'll want to know what I'm doing and, you know, he'll try and take the project forward. He'll pitch and all that stuff. He's always done that for me, looked out for me in that sense. He still feels my Hindi, you know, work should have been on a better platform, so to speak, and stuff, you know. So, and he was one of the few people who kept saying, don't do Ek Diwanata and, you know, don't do it this way and stuff. But we just got carried away with the whole thing. And Kumararaja is somebody, even though he's made just one film, I just like him for who he is. You know, he's a very simple guy, but I know his sensibilities are extraordinary and stuff. So I went into this film with a DVD that was given to me, Race.
Okay.
And they asked me to remake this film. So I said, I convinced Ajith sir, I don't want to remake anything. And I said, if you give me like a month, I'll write it. So I went in with a 60% script. And then we took the film forward. Because it was set up like that and we had to shoot immediately, I reached out to Shridhar and said, you know, I have this issue and I have just a few ideas and all that, so let's collaborate. He listened to what I had and he set up the whole organ trade idea within that. And then he just heard me out. And sometimes that's all you need. Halfway through the film, or maybe three-fourths into the film, with the last act sort of opening up, I was discussing with Kumararaja and I asked him whether, you know, you can give me a certain, you know, sort of guidance here. And he gave me a few ideas, a couple of lines here and there. And he saw it as a story of two people. He said, I know there's Satyadev and then somewhere along the way there's Victor, but I see it as two people who start off their journeys together. But there is a boy in a restaurant where a murder happens, where somebody gets shot. The man who gets shot, his son is orphaned that day. And he has to take a call as to which path his journey will, right, you know, unfold. And there's another boy who's a cleaner boy in the restaurant who gets beaten up by the restaurant owner, who sees the antagonist who shot the, you know, simple guy walking away and saying, I want to be like him. So it's two people on either side of a line. And you have it already in the script, Gautham. Why don't you make it this, he said. And I was blown by that. So he pointed that out and I just etched that out. It didn't make it to the final cut for various reasons. But we'd actually released that version in the US prints and stuff.
Okay.
But the Tamil version didn't get to see this exact two men and their story kind of a thing. It still became a film about the protagonist. And somewhere along the way, there's an antagonist who comes in sort of a thing. So they were solid bounce board.
Were you inspired by any other cop films? You know, there's a clip of Moondru Mugam that plays on a television set. Was there a bit of homage thing going on there?
Yes, it was, because there's this actual scene where in Arindhaal also, where Ashish Vidyarthi walks in and takes Ajith on. So that was completely inspired by Moondru Mugam. It's one of those scenes that I'm sure for you and for a lot of people who know films from that era, it's etched in my mind, you know. So automatically I was waiting for a moment to bring that in somewhere. And then it was just a touch to have that playing, you know, when the scene plays out. So it was completely inspired by that moment.
You're nothing!
Satya!
And I am a police officer, DCP Satyadev.
And I wouldn't, you know, say that I haven't seen the films like certain other filmmakers.
Wow. So in Kaakha Kaakha, you have a cop exploring a relationship. In Vettaiyaadu Vilaiyaadu, you take it a step further and bring in an angle of a woman who is somebody else's wife and a child. Now in Yennai Arindhaal, you push that thing even further. Is that what you meant when you said this was a trilogy? So in a way, you can kind of look at this as the story of the same cop, but maybe played
exactly
at different time zones in his life.
Exactly. When I finished Kaakha Kaakha, I wanted to do this. Strangely, I got an opportunity to work with Kamal sir, and when I pitched the same idea in my head as I started writing, so I went through the same process of should the protagonist be a doctor, or you know, should he be a normal guy, a common man, which in Unne Poluruvan he did, right? So I had a similar kind of an idea at that point. And then I narrated the story of Pachikali Muthucharam to him. And he liked it, but he said, I don't think this will work when you and I are coming together. People might want a bigger film. So obviously he wanted me to direct Dasavatharam, and we went on that for about 3 months. But it was so built inside him that I felt I won't do justice to something like that. And I have an issue with shooting, you know, one actor playing 8-9 roles. 2 roles itself I have a problem with. And now I was wondering about the whole technique behind shooting that and getting into it and stuff. I had to be completely dependent on the cameraman. I don't want to do all that. So I kind of excused myself out of that script. And then managed to narrate this to like a first half kind of an extent. And he liked it and he said, let's go. But it was always Anbu Chelvan 10 years from now. And it was Raghavan at one point and Satyadev. I just didn't want to give them the same names, but it was still within the same, it's the same character, like you said.
Right.
So when people actually said, I'm just getting repetitive and doing the same thing, somewhere I had a quiet laugh because they didn't get it that it was meant to be a trilogy, it was meant to be the same character in different forms sort of thing.
But then extending this, you could pretty much make a movie every, let's say, 5 years where, because this is infinitely extendable, right?
So I have an idea of the same character who's now 60 and who's retired. And then he comes back with a team and stuff like that. So we explored, we put that idea into Yennai Arindhaal, where he pulls off from the force because of a child.
Right.
So imagine a Lal sir, you know, playing a 60-year-old cop.
Right.
Who's gone off the force. And just before he's leaving, or maybe that night, there's something that comes up.
Right.
And then now he's not on the force, but he comes back only with his instinct and everything to investigate issues with the existing department. So it's such a beautiful angle to explore and take forward. It can go in different directions. It can really go on, actually.
You actually have an idea for Yennai Arindhaal 2.
Yeah.
Okay.
I have an idea for Yennai Arindhaal 2. It's a 30-person script now. And I promise Ajith sir, the next time I come, it will be a full-bound script.
Okay.
Because he did wait a very long time for the climax. For the last act, he kept asking me. And I thought he was a little bothered by that. So it's my fault completely. So I thought the next time I go to him, which I can go anytime, I'm hoping, I'll give him a full-bound script and take it forward.
So let me ask you about one particular point in the screenplay where Victor discovers that Satyadev is a cop, right? So because he's thinking he's a friend till then. Now, in today's day and age when it's already revealed to, you know, that Ajith is playing a cop, it's a reveal actually only to Victor in the story, not to the audience, because they already know that this is... Do you think that kind of... did you anticipate?
No, I think the screenplay was wrong. I toyed a lot with that to change it around. But then we had... So, if you notice in the first 10 minutes, we're trying to sort of mask the fact that... But we're actually putting him in the right places.
Right.
He's actually outside Anushka's house.
Yeah.
He comes and meets a few people who are very cop-like.
Yeah.
But I'm hoping audience will think, okay, something bizarre is happening. So, he says, keep an eye, keep a watch, gets into a car and he heads off from there.
Right.
And then at the coffee shop, he's sitting and Victor comes in, there's a fight sequence. And then to Anushka, he starts to talk. Even then, we don't reveal. The bizarre aspect is, Ratnam sir wanted to call this film Satyadev IPS. So I'm trying to tell him, sir, as it is, you know, it's only a reveal to the character. The audience already knows, I'm sure the word will go out. It'll all be for the first show only because it's an Ajith film. It's the mass audience which the word will go out, right? So I still feel, given a chance, given a shot at probably a Hindi version, a screenplay would be different. Like, I wouldn't try to hide the fact that, you know, there's a cop that who's the protagonist and stuff like that.
Your heroines are, like, idealized women, but in a way, the father characters in your films are even more idealized. They're wonderful people. They have the best advice to give, you know, and even here, Ajith not only has a great father in Nasir, he himself becomes a great father. Have you ever thought of having a father who's not so perfect?
No, it bothers me.
No, it doesn't bother me.
No, it bothers me to have anything otherwise. Like I remember telling K.V. Anand sir that when I saw Matran, it bothered me completely that the father was the, you know, the antagonist sort of in the film. I know when you write a great screenplay or you're setting up a story, conflict is always good. It's very nice to have, if you go to a screenplay class or a story session, class. This is what they'll teach you. Have conflicts. Have characters who are bad apples and, yeah. you know, and then bring them out and stuff like that. But I somehow can't see a bad father. Even if I want to write it, I won't be able to. So I bring in conflict with other stuff. But with the father, it has to be idealistic for me. I don't know why. You can call it a major problem in my head, but I can't do anything else with that.
The soul of Yennai Arindhaal is in the father-daughter scenes. Did it seem that way to you as well?
Yes.
Even though it's a cop movie, you saw it as a story between a father and
a daughter. That's what I narrated to Ajith, sir. I said he's left with his child, who's not biologically his child. He gives everything, he puts out everything for her, leaves the force for her. They take off on a journey, and then he's brought back because of a friend's daughter going missing, and something unravels. So this is what he heard, and it's what he liked. So that was the story. So obviously, in this story, I have to have a woman. I made her like a very Shobana-esque kind of a personality. You know, she's arrogant about her work, but she's a sweetheart, and then they fall in love. So the whole Anushka angle was brought in later because there was an actor who was already been signed. So this was a story, and that's why we focus a lot more. We travel the length and breadth of all those locations that you see in that song, actual locations where they travel from Chennai to wherever they end up in that school, and he's a teacher and she's a student. We went on that location because everybody understood that this is the soul of the film.
You just spoke of the song. It's a great song. Lyrics are astounding, Thamarai's lyrics. And one of the lyrics actually makes it back into a voiceover by Ajith. What was your brief to Thamarai at this point?
So it was Harris and Thamarai at the same time. I said, see, obviously when there's a child, it's a Thalattu song, right? So I said, this is what it should be. But then let's not make it so much of something like that. So you just need to... I just told him it's somebody who's taken off with his child. There's a train journey. And then he goes to these places. He ends up in a school. And she's much smaller at that point. And then about 3 to 4 years will pass. He gets a job in the same school. And he looks after her. And he becomes he's a father. But he's actually, when he's not, he's also her mother.
Yeah.
So which is why we had the small moments of Happy Father's Day. And then the Mother's Day and all that stuff. So, and I had a clear idea of where the song would go. I remember him just sitting and then coming up with this tune, which I really liked, and Thamarai was also there. And I gave her a small, like, she always wants an opening line or a connect with what she can go into, right? So I think my brief was to her was, tell me what you want, and let me show you the world. And let me also discover this world along with you. And then she came up with some magical, you know, stuff. It was Harris' idea to come back with a sort of a version of the song when Anushka walks into the house, because he felt the song was in Ajith's head, and that's what should be playing to the audience when she walks back into the house. It was such a poignant shoot, you know, because we were in love with the song, everybody was. And it just worked so magically, I think. I mean, that's the best part of the film for me.
So your songs are amazing in a way because you pack in so much information. I mean, not necessarily every song, because some songs are choreographed and things like that. Yeah. But I'm talking about these kind of montage songs, right? You actually tell a whole passage of a story.
Yes.
In Unkannenna Venum Sollu, in Marivara Pogude. There's actually like
you're taking
narrative trajectories happening there. Do you ever worry whether the audience will just switch off during that time because and lose that thing? Because, you know, when people are used to getting things in terms of like scene, and you know, that song happens and suddenly they think, oh, it's just a song, let me walk out and come back kind of thing.
No, but it was never have I ever thought that they lose the connect. And it's also challenging to keep that audience in the theatre, right? So which is why visually it has to be stunning. There has to be a story. If there is no reason for the song to be there, it will not work. I'm very sure of that.
Right.
Even the choreographed, like proper dance songs, I've given the choreographer a complete brief of what kind of choreography I want. And most of the songs I choreograph myself. Like even a song like Omana Pinde and Hosanna and Vinnithandi, we had somebody with us who was an Irish sort of a choreographer. He didn't get it at all. So I was getting all the stuff done by Simbu. So I was telling Simbu, for this beat, bro, can you show me something like this? And I wouldn't want to show him by dancing, but I will get that stuff from him. I'll say, oh yeah, let's capture this. It won't work otherwise. Unless you sit there with a great brief, you can't inspire, you know, and if you just tell them you want a love song or you want a song where father and daughter are just traveling, it doesn't work. You have to inspire them a lot, and I completely believe in that.
And your, yeah, the fact that the audience travels with you
has never bothered me. I think I've clearly established that I've never worried about while I'm making the film and just about to release. I don't do focus screenings, and I don't show the film to like 15 people or and then discuss and cut and stuff. If the hero, it has never happened also. So I go through a little shell when, you know, 1 week before release or the day before release and stuff. I believe the whole concept of filmmaking is to make the film and put it out there and see what the audience will take from it. And protect the film with the correct commercials and the correct economics, I'm saying. So I don't go ballistic on my budget where, you know, the film tanks, nobody loses like too much of money and stuff like that. So, yeah.
So Unkannenna Venum Sollu is also a journey. In terms of like a personal journey, not just for the daughter, but also for the father. And there's a similar journey in Vaaranam Aayiram as well, where you kind of have you take a pause from the main story and kind of go into this journey for the personal development aspect of it. What interests you in this?
Well, I'm fascinated by journeys. I'm fascinated by journeying for your mind, you know. I always feel that even if somebody is just traveling tonight to go somewhere, during that journey, there's lots of thoughts that open up in your head, and you're reflecting on your life, and you're looking at what's ahead. And for that 8 to 10 hours or for the 24 hours, and when you reach somewhere, you kind of move on to what the purpose of the journey was. But I'm fascinated by the whole travel angle. And with Vaaranam Aayiram especially, with somebody, you know, with substance abuse and drinking and stuff like that, I decided I will not do a rehab scene. I said, this guy will travel, he will explore, and then he will work on his physique to come out of whatever he's doing. We did speak to a couple of doctors who said, yes, it is possible. Even Vinay Thandi, there's a journey. Everywhere there's a journey, you know.
Did you feel that this journey, this father-daughter journey, kind of, because it occupies the middle of the screenplay, that it kind of edged out the villain a bit in terms of the larger scheme of things, because he appears at the beginning and then, you know, for a long time we lose sight of him, and then he kind of appears again at the end.
I thought it was a good thing, because otherwise, see, in this kind of film, you already know he's a cop coming to the theater, and then there's a seemingly gangster episode where these two are friends. You know he's going to pull out the gun at some point. So for me, this seemed like an interesting 20-25 minutes
diversion
to let the audience sort of forget about Victor in this film, or know somewhere that he's looming large at the back of your head, and when will he come up, sort of thing. So I only use it as a nice tool, I'm thinking, you know. It seemed like work for me.
You once said that for me the first draft contains the real essence of the story and that you had in your mind. Do you still work like that?
Yeah, completely. It's like how the film is also made. I don't like to tweak it, show it around and stuff like that. So I feel, and it's also like when I'm working with the actor on the sets, there's some discussion, and then I don't allow them to rehearse too much.
Right.
Because then it gets very mechanical and stuff. Sometimes, with especially the established actors, they know, right? A first take is like a magical take always, and that's very raw. And you just need to be in the right place to capture that. Anything beyond that gets orchestrated and doesn't get organic is what I feel. So likewise, with the writing process, I feel whatever comes out of your head first, the second day, if you revisit that, you're bound to change it. I don't revisit that. And I'm very impatient in the sense, once I have an 80% script, I'm talking for a producer or like-minded people like my team to green light and say, let's just go ahead and shoot. So that's how I worked in all my, you know, 14-15 films that I've done so far.
There's one school that says, you know, you do what you have to do and then leave it aside for 3 months and then come back to it and see. And
I know. I know that school, and I've heard that, I've studied about that and stuff. I don't think it'll work for me. Okay. It has to be very natural and organic, I think.
So. And that's your first instinct.
Yeah.
Tell us about the voiceovers. You've always had them, and you know, they've always indicated a kind of, I don't think there's a problem, because, you know, a lot of people, you know, a film is an audio visual medium. So, you know, you're using audio in a different kind of way. Where I'm interested in is, in this film, it's not just the voiceover of the adult cop, there's the voiceover of the child.
அவங்க எல்லாரையும் பழி வாங்கணும்னு தோணுச்சு. இல்ல அவங்கள ஒருத்தன் ஆகணும்னு தோணுச்சு.
There's the voiceover of the girl.
பக்கி மாதிரி பிஹேவ் பண்ணியாச்சு. பரவால. எப்பயாவது தானே.
There's all kinds of voiceovers happening, and like as we mentioned, just talked about a little bit earlier, there's also voiceover in terms of he repeats the lyric from that thing, you know, Ulaganum Paramapadam, that line.
Ulaganum Paramapadam, Vilindapin Vairvavaram, நினைத்தத நினைக்காதது நடக்கும் தெரிந்த சருணா.
So were you in this particular film, were you pushing how you were using voiceover so far, kind of like doing something more formal with it?
Yeah, I've never seen it as a tool to avoid filming something or like a connect between scenes that I haven't thought of and stuff like that. It's designed to a large extent in the film when I write itself. I'm a huge fan of, I think, Shawshank Redemption, and it's left a huge sort of imprint in my head, like with the way Morgan Freeman's voice travels through the entire film.
Right.
Seen it many years ago, and that's sort of still etched in my head, right? So I've started writing like that. In this film, once we came to the dubbing stage, we had two sessions of one dubbing for the entire film and then dubbing for the voiceovers, where Ajith said he wants to stand over the mic kind of thing, you know, and give it like one third dimension kind of a thing, which really worked. I've actually pushed the voiceover to a big extent with Enenoki Payam Thota. I mean, okay. I've done stuff like Naa Oru Thirumbi Paatha, Avana Paathutte Irundha, that kind of stuff. I think it's a very Guy Ritchie kind of a treatment, and I thought, why not, you know, let's do that. With Dhanush, it seems so easy to do that.
Feminine characters are usually like two extremes. There's the delicate dance teacher like Hemanika, Trisha, the Trisha character. Or there's, you find the other end, which is like a Vijay Shanti kind of action heroine. Is there a middle road? I'm not necessarily asking in your films.
Yeah.
But we don't see too much of a middle path for...
Yeah, actually true, right? Is Aruvi a middle path kind of a heroine?
I would still call Aruvi an angry heroine though.
Yeah,
you true. Know, because she is angry yeah, about a lot of yeah. things. So
actually, roles for women are very, very less yeah. good roles, I'm saying here, right? They're not etched out properly at all. I think a lot of Balachandra's films has, there'll be a Suhasini and there'll be a Sulakshana also.
Right.
You know, that's the only example that I can think of. If you look at a film like Agni Nakshatram, both Nirosha and Amla have their own say with a lot of things.
Right.
She's bold enough to call out saying, you know, I love this guy and stuff like that. Amla's bold enough to smoke a cigarette and stuff. I think the middle path of Vinay Thandi Varuva is Jessie, right? I think to a large extent.
Probably, yes.
Yeah, because she takes a couple of decisions and then she backs off. So I've shown her graph to be something like that, I think.
Right, right.
But I can't think of many other characters like that. I can't think of a good role for women these days, actually.
All your cop films have this dimension of a dead wife or lover. Is this to introduce a kind of a tragic dimension to the hero, in the sense of make the audience feel a little more for him, or is there something else?
I think it's to show the danger associated with the work that he's in. I did, during Kaakha Kaakha, I did speak to a lot of people. I did speak to one of the top cops and his wife, and she said, I've got threats on the phone saying your husband won't come back this evening, ask him to lay off and stuff like that. And all that. So this is all stuff that I've actually spoken to people who've been hardcore with their work. So I thought, see, that's the thing again, right? If I show people being from a very normal sort of a setting, then loss will be in a sort of a different perspective. That's a very natural, you know,
right,
death,
right.
Or like the Vaaranam Aayiram father who right. has to die because he's got cancer.
But the Vaaranam Aayiram heroine.
Yeah.
She dies as well.
Yeah, so yeah. That's where so for me, that's translated as a first love sort of a thing. Obviously, the concept of first love is because that doesn't, the girl or the guy doesn't exist anymore as far as the relationship is concerned, right? Which is why you talk about it as your first love.
Right, right.
And then you move on and meet somebody else. For me, I've always translated that to death for some strange, bizarre reason. So instead of showing them as just being separated or moving away and they've gone off in life, I kind of convert that into, you know, the woman completely gone. If I do that with the men, I think this question won't even come up later. But I haven't done it. I've only done it with the women. So it's just that. For me, that loss of a girl going away is equivalent to death. And how does this guy come out from that sort of a thing?
Right, and so, it's interesting that in your films, both Vaaranam Aayiram and Yennai Arindhaal, they act as a kind of catalyst in growth.
Hmm.
You know, the death actually results in not just mourning, but almost like a transformed behavior.
Yeah. Yeah, because in Yennai Arindhaal is interesting because she dies on the night before the wedding. Strangely or conveniently the girl insists on being with Ajith for that night, and then he goes looking for these guys, leaving the child in a hotel room,
right.
And he's injured and he realizes he could have died. Transformation happens, he pulls off from the force. Yeah, so see, the problem right now is I'm getting into three films where I've done pretty much a similar thing, you know, so which is why in Dhruva Nakshatram I've not done that very consciously. Like I've very consciously not wanted the girl to be targeted by the villains, or you know, and somebody who's gone away from his life still existing, and they meet much later and stuff like that. So I think I'm also evolving in that sense.
Do you write everything in your scripts, including staging directions, or do you just write the bare bones of a screenplay and then go and find the movie on the sets?
I find the movie completely. I've never written a treatment note. So I do a shoot script on like the night before, which is for me to figure out what I'm shooting in terms of dialogues and stuff. And sometimes when it's a little complicated, I break the shots down. So like in my head, and for maybe the cinematographer to know, I'll say these are the master shots and I want a couple of these. But then everything will change depending on the actor and the environment. It will change. Which is why I've never done a storyboard, because I just like to, like today if you say, we've not got that location, there's some issue, the house is crumbled, let's shift here and shoot, I'm ready to shoot here immediately. I just need to come, sit, look at it for like some 10 minutes and immediately the shot division will unfold. And I feel that's a very nice, organic way of making a film. But I'm also in control of production at the same time.
Right.
I know I'm not spending extra money. I've not asked for too many things in the last minute and stuff. And I think my team that's working with me now for 6-7 years, they know there might be one or two surprises, but they'll be small. And I've never gone on a location recce. Like Vinitandi, I said, Manoj, I've given you the idea of the script. You go and find your locations. I want water. I want Alapi, you know, but I don't want to come. You fix the blocks and surprise me so that I can just come and do my bit there. And from then on, every film I work like that. So, yeah.
For Vettaiyaadu Vilaiyaadu, you said, the first half is what I wanted to do. The second half is what I did for the producer and for Kamal sir. In hindsight, how would you look back on Yennai Arindhaal?
It's not that I did a second half completely for the producer. It was still organic, the way it worked in and stuff. But there were some moments that Mr. Narayanan came and said, you know, so why isn't there a song here and stuff? So I said, sir, it doesn't work. No, we need... So once we finished principal shooting, we actually went back to shoot Nerupe Sikki Mukki Nerupe. And in the edit, what I did, I showed the journey of these two guys. They're shifting, they're moving trains, they right. You know. And intercut that with one Goan kind of a setting, which we shot here actually. So those kind of small things were done. And then towards the climax, there was a big action sequence planned between Daniel Balaji and Kamal sir. With Daniel Balaji's partner, the other guy, Kamal sir kills him, shoots him down, and then goes after him. And then, I think that's about the point when Kamal sir started getting interested in the film. Because by then he'd seen a trailer, he liked what he saw. Till then he was like, what are these guys doing, just making me walk and stuff like that. I don't think he got many scenes, like he was asking me, who's this, who's that. And I feel bad to say this, but then he was more focused on Dasavatharam at that time, and he wanted me directed. He was a little cross with me that I didn't say yes to him. I know he said, you're an ad filmmaker, so why can't you just give direct material that's given to you and stuff. So even though there was respect and, you know, I was a fanboy around him and treated him really well, and I kept asking him, can we do one more take and stuff like that, I didn't sense that sort of that embrace from him, is what I'm saying, which I was longing for. So when I showed him the trailer, he was like, oh. And I saw that expression, he liked it. And then he said, how many more days of shoot? I said, we're done. The last 3 days, action sequence, showed him the whole, you know, scene with the stunt choreographer and everything. And he said, why don't I just... So this is the end of the film, Gautham. There's a whole cat and mouse. I understand now what you've done and everything. Let's just finish him off in one shot. Why have a fight with me and him? What about this? He's a younger guy and stuff, no? And to show the prowess of a cop and everything. So I was a little bothered, but I knew it was not that he didn't want to shoot for the next 3 days. But he was making sense. And I was just hoping that he'd make me understand that. And he explained and he devised the whole thing, and that whole last sequence was an idea given by him. So then we worked out a situation where they come at each other and one chop, it's over. And actually in the theatres, if you watch it, the audience is expecting one build up fight there, but it's over in like a second. And it's over. And after that, he just goes in looking for where Jyotika is buried, right? So nothing was majorly changed because of the producer, but these kind of moments, you know, which when he said it, I had to change from what I had written and stuff like that. In Yennai Arindhaal, there was nothing of that sort. It was completely Ajith sir, like I said before, telling me, just make what you think is right and I'll just be in this. The producer, of course, had lots of issues with, okay, so he's a producer who's made, you know, films with Shankar and, you know, the big films and stuff. So he wanted everything big. And I'm not a big filmmaker. I can make things look big, but spending small money, you know. So it was fun working on that film, whatever it was, because I was actually working with a star with a super mass image. And you've seen the other films that he's done in the past 3-4 years.
Right.
And this is a complete, you know, change from all that. Now, how much the film collected and stuff is just a sort of a relative equation where you spend so much on a film and the film collects so much. You spend little, but a film collects so much. So that year, the small films that made bigger money and a big film that made slightly bigger money, it was equated like that, you know, and somewhere the producer also didn't put the word out that the film has done well and stuff. So I think I got caught in all that.
So let me just ask you one last question based on what you said, Kamal Haasan asked you. You said that if you're an ad filmmaker, can you ever work off a script that is not yours?
Yeah, I'm starting to do that now. But I've never liked being an ad filmmaker. Somewhere you have to own it, right? I'm not talking in terms of proprietary ownership sort of a thing. You need to own it. Like, you need to know what you're doing. It has you have to internalize it.
But as a director, you are going to be overseeing the development of the script, right? It's not going to do something and come and give you a bounce.
An ad film, they just give it to you.
Right. And I'm talking about as a feature film.
Yeah. So feature film, I need to interact with the writer. I need to know that this is something that I would have also written. And it's not something like Interstellar where I can see the film, yes, but it's not something that I would write. I'm not into fantasy. I can't do Game of Thrones.
Right.
I can't do a Bahubali. I can do stuff that people know will believe, can believe that will happen. Can be from a house or it can be in a police station. I know I'm restricted in that sense, but I'm exploring now. So I'm actually rewriting a film that Reshma has written completely. But it's something that I could have also written.
Right.
It's just, she's made it easier for me by giving me a full-bound script and it's emotional, it's fun, you know, it's got a journey. It's stuff that I can put myself into. If I take it to Rehman sir who's doing the music for this film, I can just completely believe that I've written it and give him song situations and stuff like that.
Right.
With Dasavatharam, I didn't feel that. You know what I'm saying? He narrated beautifully. There was so much of vision. There was Crazy Mohan, there was Sujata sir, you know, there was a whole team of Kamal sir people, you know, whom as people in the industry we've heard of. And I was in awe of them. And 10 days of discussion about the script. And I was sitting in those discussions. I was giving them suggestions. But at every point when I used to go back home, I remember telling my wife that I can't see myself doing this. I'm very worried. I don't want to shoot even double action of somebody. How can I set up 9 people? I have to be dependent on the cameraman. You know, how will people take this? It's not mine. I was saying all that. So she just said, if that's what you feel, then just tell him. It's best to tell him. So I just disappeared for about 2 weeks. And then he spoke to somebody in the unit who told him that, you know, I don't see the film happening and stuff. Then he called me back and said, okay, what do you have? And the police story, then I said, panla, he said. So that's how that happened. I stopped doing ad films because when the soft drink ads come to me, I know I don't drink those soft drinks. And why am I just making, you know, a film on that line?
Okay.
And they have concepts that don't really work. And you just, as a filmmaker and as a technician, you're setting up your shots, but your heart is not in that, right? So I felt I was not doing right by what I've learned and what I'm here for, right? So I stopped doing those films. There are some couple of small films that I've done where there's a father and son who go to the showroom to buy a bike and the dad is blind. No, I like that. This I thought was, you know, workable. So the Pankaj Kapoor film that happened in Hindi, the Prakash Raj version I did in Tamil, and I like the script. Something like that I can own, you know, and I find it relatable and stuff like that. So that's my issue.
When people say it's a Gautham Menon film, Gautham Menon padam mari irukku, do you think that's a plus, or do you think that's kind of shows that people can easily say what kind of film you kind of make?
It's an advantage these days, I feel. I've said this before, I keep a few motives here and there, which even in a Mani
like
Ratnam
everybody,
film,
yeah,
you
yeah.
will see,
like all
you
major
know,
filmmakers,
and I love that.
Yeah, yeah.
For me, it's never a problem. It's not me thinking, why is he repetitive or why is he doing the same thing?
Right.
You know, for me, it's a touch. And I think it's, obviously, if you look at what is this film? I think in Guru, right? There's a moment where, there's a Nayaganist moment where he goes back and there's a picture on the mantle, which reminds you of the moment from Nayagan, right? I mean, obviously the man knows it. It's not like he's forgotten that he's done that, right? But it's a, I think it's a touch. I love that. So I don't mind the mechanical engineering angle, the heroes wearing, which I'm not doing now, but I'm just saying. So small, small touches, the way songs are handled, the way the women are dressed and all that, I don't mind doing that, I'm saying.
Fantastic. Thank you so much.
Thank you. It's always a pleasure to talk to you. You bring out a lot of stuff from me, which takes me back to my earlier films and reminds me that there are certain ways to make a film. And I've had these, you know, earlier interactions with you over emails and texts, and I was thinking of that as we were talking. Why did I start taking you seriously? Because I didn't know you at all, and I've somewhere never really cared for critics and stuff. But the way you looked at every film from that point made me take you very seriously from the beginning itself. And I would have a problem if somebody told me that, you know, Bharadwaj didn't like your film. So for that one day, I'm actually looking to see what your review is more than anything else.
Oh God, this is too much pressure. But thank you so much.
No, please hate my film, because it keeps me thinking, right? Okay, somebody doesn't like your film.
Right.
And if that's the collective audience feel also, it actually, you know, it helps you to sort of step back and then move on to make something better. Yeah.
Thank you.